Hi, folks, I'm Dave Lindsay. Dave Beersdorfer asked me to say a few words if I tried not to mumble. He cannot be here tonight. It gives me great pleasure to speak because Bob has been doing a lot of things for this setup in addition to what he's going to tell you about tonight. I have a couple housekeeping items. If you have to go to the bathroom, you can. Our water supply is shut off for another month. We've got frozen pipes under the driveway, and we have a problem. However, if you're desperate, I have a key I can get you into the lavatories across the courtyard. Also, I just wanted to bring to your attention that there will be a blood drive here on the 14th. Again, this year, and it's an outstanding activity. Plus, because our students are involved, they're eligible for scholarships from my Bob's sponsorship of that particular activity. So, a couple housekeeping chores.
And an invitation to help yourself to coffee,
that's right,
cider, cheese, crackers, some cookies, grapes, pretzels.
Thank you.
Many of you know Bob's skills and Bob's employment successes. I know of those, but I also want to add one more personal comment is the fact that he's one of the volunteers that's come here and really helped. I don't know a lot of mechanical things. I'm not skilled, and he's one of the people who brought his son, he brought Phil West, and they came here and helped us with this monster cage that had very poor directions that came with it, and they figured out how to set it up. That's the good news. The bad news is I got another one for them.
We got another one to go, right?
Up in the other corner, but we do have, we're getting a lot of use now in the building. And there are some areas that need to be locked because there are folks that don't have anything to do with them. They're going to be working somewhere else. But the robotics high school team will be moving here permanently in June when they finish their competitive season. And that's something actually those folks and I spent years trying to keep this building. And they were part of it, their parents and the students themselves said, what a great place to put our robotics team because this floor is large enough for a full-size competitive field. And so we'll certainly use it for rehearsals and those kinds of things. But I'll stop and I'll let Bob begin.
Well, thank you. Just a note to add about the Science and Technology Center. Just today, I forwarded an application to Ian and to Dave. There was a group of folks, professionals, mostly contractors and HVAC people, electricians and so forth, that at the initial, while the SDC was still, well, it was progressed a little bit past the glimmer in the 21st century fund's eye, it was looking to potentially take advantage of some of the expertise around the area. And that group now wants to come back together and come back here and convene meetings with some degree of frequency.
That's great.
Yeah, to, again, invite the community at large, have speakers, and basically share experiences about the whole concept of green building, because it is, in a lot of cases, sometimes more art than science. So, I mean, there are some science to it. And there is some data, certainly, that supports certain sorts of things. And one of the premises that I've always worked on is that regardless of what someone's, if you will, political bent may be, you can always make a compelling argument with regard to any kind of investment when you can lay out an efficient and effective return on that investment. And that's regardless of whether it's a homeowner or a business person. So one of my approaches to any of the systems that my colleagues and I have gotten involved with over the years here has always been to lay out what's an anticipated return on investment based on some good statistical data. And I offer this to anybody who has never had an opportunity to see how one of these proposals actually comes together and where the references come from for the numbers that say, well, you're going to see a 10-year payback or a 20-year payback, or, you know, you shouldn't even buy green bananas at this point. So, you know, but the challenge is really determining if the system has a reasonable payback. And reasonable is going to be a different, if you will, term for everybody. So, and for the type of project, and it will depend on factors like, do you intend to live in the home? Or do you intend to stay in the business? Or are you leasing a property that you're only in for 10 years? And you don't know what your lease is going to do after 10 years if it's a convert commercial installation. And obviously the state of Connecticut is deeply, deeply involved in energy and efficiency measures, but I'm going to speak to some of the really simplistic ones that they're involved with here right now. But they do everything from process controls to motor changeouts to lighting and everything else through the Connecticut Energy Finance and Investment Authority, the Clean Energy Investment and Financing Authority. But the factors in determining the reasonable payback period are really the durable life of the equipment, number one. I mean, typically the equipment, the types of products we're installing, you're seeing anywhere from 10 to 30 to lifetime warranties on certain of the products. So you have an expectation that it should be around. Obviously, whatever the warranty is, but the potential longevity of the vendor should be vetted in some ways too. As an example, I have on our roof in Washington Supply four different types of photovoltaic. Three of the manufacturers are gone. We only installed it in 2010. The potential for the investment recovery, well, obviously, too, the age of the investors and the current energy use, I mean, sometimes it doesn't make sense. There's a kind of a, it's almost like a curve like this where the costs go up and then they level out. So up through a point, it gets very, very expensive to install a system. So if you're doing a very small one, what I have a tendency to call ecosystems, they don't make sense. You know, if you're only going to put 200 square feet of solar thermal up or 200 square feet of PV up. PV has a decent offset, but it costs you just as much to do it almost, you know, for the installation cost, not necessarily the actual equipment cost, as it does to do a full-blown large installation. And the age of the investor is obviously a determinant. You know, a joke about the buying green bananas, and some people don't care, but they still, it's a factor. I mean, what do you intend to do with the property down the road? Drives a lot of the decision making too. There is a potential for investment recovery, so that has to be considered. And I'll speak to some of the statistics with that. And of course, then there's the environmental benefit and carbon footprint reduction as a result of reducing your energy consumption. But the primary elements of the payback period analysis are the net cost of the project after incentives, federal and state, the projected number of watts BTUs to be generated by the project, daily, monthly, annually, the cost per unit of energy being offset, and then the conversion to a common denominator for the relative offset. Because sometimes they don't speak the same language. You know, you're talking amps and watts and BTUs, and certain of these things don't mesh. And what you'll find, although my son just discovered that I did make a mistake with it, there's a little cheat sheet here that you can take with you after, you know, that you're welcome to some of the foundations of where the calculations come from here. So, I'm going to start real simple. What's a watt? No. Well, amp times the volt equals a watt. So a half an amp at 120 volts, which is your household current, is going to give you 60 watts. Pretty simple. That's an incandescent light bulb. And that's why your breaker is rated in amps, because in some circuits in your home, you're going to have 240 running through it, i.e. your stove to your dryer. And in some other circuits, you're going to have 120 volts running to it. So that's why your breakers are always rated in amps. because it depends on whether the voltage is coming in as 120 or 240. So on a 20-amp circuit, as an example, typical household circuit, average plug like that, you have a 20-amp breaker times 120 volts, you could put 2,400 watts on it. A hair dryer is about 1,500 watts. Think about it. A few lights are, you know, 100 watts a piece, or could be potentially, unless you're using LEDs these days. Or you could be starting up a motor that all of a sudden can grab 2,000 watts real quick while you got somebody else running at 2,000 watts. There goes your circuit breaker. And you go, why is that? Why did that happen? Because sometimes the startup on an electrical circuit is great. So, but that's how you really can think about wattage, is this amps times volts equal watts. And very simply said, you take your wattage, divide it by your voltage, and that'll tell you how many amps you need to actually do something. So it's, you know, it's a, one of those flip around kinds of mathematical formulas that you can look at. So, and then what's a BTU? Because that's your common measure of heat and or heat energy. BTU, or British Thermal Unit, is the amount of energy it takes to raise 1 pound of water 1 degree at 1 atmosphere, real simply said. So if you think about it, a gallon of water is 8.3 pounds. It takes 8.35 BTUs to raise that gallon of water 1 degree. Okay, so that these are the foundations of many of the calculations, BTUs and watts. Anybody have any questions about those for everyone? So just as an example, we did have at the 80-gallon tank, and you fill it with 55-degree water, which is what typically comes out of your municipal supply or out of your well. You want the water to be 115 degrees so that you can take a shower with it, your hot water tank. You're looking for a 60-degree rise. So 80 times 8.35, or the pounds per gallon, times the 60-degree rise, that's the number of BTUs it takes to accomplish that. Now, I'm not even factoring some, you know, losses in the tank, all the rest of that, but just straight up, that is what it takes to actually bring a tank of water up. An average hot water tank loses a degree an hour, or uses 668 BTUs just to maintain its temperature, which you're going to see through this, all convertible back and forth, depending on what your energy source is. BTU example converted to watts. To produce the 40,800 BTUs we're talking about to bring that tank up, you would need 40 times a factor of 0.293, which is the conversion between BTUs to watts. Again, just a unit of measure of energy. So 40,800 times 0.293 would tell you that you need almost 12,000 watts of electricity to bring that tank up. And if you have a 4,000 watt element in the tank, it's going to take it a minimum of 3 hours to generate that many BTUs. And at the price per kilowatt, it's going to cost you about $2.27 to do that. So that's, you know, I mean, it's just a, it's a pure example. I've got 80 gallons of water that I need to bring up to 115 degrees. So now you see why your energy bills, day by day by day, and this is more the type of thing that you're just looking at for hot water. So depending on how you get your hot water. So think about this. Some of the major energy consuming pieces of equipment you have are, as we, so many of us do out here, have, are well pumps. You're going to find that's one of the worst in terms of the amount of electricity that it uses. The average annual kilowatt hours that a well pump uses is almost 1,900 kilowatt hours. Current rates in Connecticut, that'd be about $380 just to run your well pump for a year at 20 cents a kilowatt hour. Refrigerator, 800 running watts, but annual consumption is about 2,700. It gets even worse. You have an electric water heater, there's your killer in your home. 4,800 on average watts to run electric water heater. At that price, you're almost $800 a year just to run that piece of equipment. Pool pump, don't even go there. If you've got a swimming pool, that gets very, very expensive. And that's only for maybe 5 months of the year around here. Residential lighting is just about 1,200 annual kilowatt hours, and that really is an old statistic because it took into consideration more incandescent use. It doesn't take into consideration fluorescent or LED use. And a computer, and that wasn't taking into consideration probably some of the newer computers that are running much more efficiently with their power and don't have cathode ray tubes. They're running on LED screens now or LCDs. But some of these are major consumers. So when you start to look at what your requirements are in a home, it really adds up pretty fast for annual kilowatt hours. The USDOE has done some work to facilitate, in particular, agencies like the Connecticut Clean Energy Finance Authority, how to estimate what energy usage will be in a new home. And the DOE, kind of taking it across a lot of different climate zones and all the rest of that, has come up with this figure that we tend to use now for new construction, which says that an average home built today without extraordinary measures will consume 4.32 kilowatt hours of electricity per square foot per year. So if a 2,000 square foot house uses about 8,640 kilowatt hours of electricity a year, has a bill of about $1,600 a year, or roughly $137,
$140
a month.
Bob, is that just with the appliances you've already shown, or is that with electric heat?
That is an average home across all types of environments. Some with electric heat, very, very few homes these days are built with electric heat, and you gotta take into consideration different climates and what they're using for, if they're using air conditioning and so forth. That's an average statistic. It really is not a pin down. And how valid is that here? On average, what I see when I do analysis of people's electrical bills and then I ask them what the size of their home is, this it feels about right. It comes back and, it could be anywhere from $4.50 to $6. It depends on what they're doing, per square foot. People's electricity usage varies widely, and it's more about the individual and they're, in my estimation, bent about making sure they turn off lights or they've employed the use of compact fluorescents or LEDs, or if they're buying Energy Star appliances and they're replacing, older appliances with the newer ones. But taking this as a basis for moving this forward, I use this as an example as where I would come from then necessarily in determining the size of a photovoltaic system for a home like that. So if it's using 8,640 kilowatt hours a year, the calculation would be as follows. Take the 8,640, divide by the 365. So my average kilowatt hours per day is about 23.7. Now, another factor we add to that is what's called insolation. Insolation is simply the incoming solar radiation. In this geographic climate here, we have an average of 4 hours per day of solar insolation, which is the exposure to sunlight. Obviously, you've got 14 hours in the summertime, and you can have one in the winter sometimes. We're so fortunate. So at average, and these stats come from NASA and a few other agencies, NOAA, that track this type of data. What I'm trying to arrive at here is if I've got 4 hours of average solar per day, then taking the 23.7 kilowatt hours a day divided by 4 and times a factor, again, for efficiency loss, conversion of electricity from a DC power plant to an AC plant, A photovoltaic system that would be sized for 100% of usage in this case would be a 7.61 kilowatt plant. Now that's exclusive of how much area I have on a roof to work with or what the customer wants to do in terms of the type of product they see. Last year I was demonstrating different types of photovoltaic products because there's some common denominators in some of those products as well in terms of their cost per watt, but certain of them are much more productive per square foot in terms of the amount of wattage that they will generate, dependent upon the type of material that's actually generating the electricity. There's what's called monocrystalline panels, polycrystalline panels, and then amorphous silicon are the three major types that are available today. But in this particular case, today's panels generate around 250 watts each. There are some that, you know, are kind of off the charts. There's a company called SunPower that makes a very expensive module that's about a 300 watt panel and about the same size as the traditional 250 watt, but the extra 50 watts are very expensive. So, you know, again, it's a balancing act. But on average, for a decent panel, they're around 250 watts today, and an average panel is about a size of a 4x7, you know, big sheet, this is what they come down to. I brought them here before, so I think people have seen this. No need for them to do that again. So in this case, a 30 panel system, which would be an even number, which is what you need, it's simpler, would generate about 7,500 watts or 7.5 kilowatts. So taking that model from there, so a 7.5 kilowatt plant. Now that would have a gross cost in the state of Connecticut through certain of the programs before the application of any of the incentives that the state's been going through of about $4.50 a watt. That would be what the installer would be looking to charge for that. Then in Connecticut, the state will offer $1.25 per watt for the first 5,000 watts and 75 cents per watt for the next 5,000 up to a maximum of 10,000. So the calculation in this case for that, the state incentive on a 7,500 watt power plant would be $7,375. From that, the federal tax credit is subsequently applied. The federal tax credit in a photovoltaic system or in any renewable energy system is an actual credit. It's, you don't pay that tax. It's not a deduction, it's a credit. That's a huge difference. In other words, if you owe the federal government $10,000 in taxes, and here the federal government's gonna give you $7,912.50, and you're only gonna owe them $2,087.50, is what it comes down to. So they subsidize it. It's one of these, I guess you gotta look at it in your mind and say, well, do I pay uncle or do I reduce my electricity over time? Because uncle's gonna get it no matter what. So might as well reduce what you pay. So the net system cost after the state incentive and the federal tax credit, $18,462.50. Okay, now here's where the return on investment comes in. We know what that cost is. So if we're going to take the present cost of electricity, and I'm going to, for the sake of this example, use 19 cents a kilowatt hour. That, if you were to look at your electric bill, you've got two components of it. You've got your delivery and your supplier services. CLMP is obviously the delivery. Supplier could be anybody. It could be one of these companies that right now, as I'm understanding it, they're charging upwards of 30 cents a kilowatt hour just for the electricity. So people have actually seen bills coming to them from CLMP for 40 cents a kilowatt hour, believe it or not. Huge bills, because they've employed the use of some of these third-party suppliers that are not long and deep in the marketplace, and they're buying on the spot market, and energy costs have been bouncing around like an old Super Bowl back in the day. They're pretty wild. So again, using 19 cents per kilowatt hour, yes, there's been a spike, but on average, it will come back. So if I take just, without even a consideration of inflation, I say with the projected annual use of 8,640 watts that I would need, times 0.19, 0.19, it would take me 11.25 years to pay for that investment. That's the direct payout. That's if I don't factor in an increase in electricity. If I factor in a 3% per year increase in electricity overall, then the payback is 10 years. Now that, again, is just a very, very overly simplified model of this, but that's the fundamental here in terms of how to determine the return on investment. Because now you have made this investment in a product, it's cost you $18,000, but you would have been paying this electricity that you're no longer paying. So at that point, you've evened out. You've gotten your money back. But now you've got a product that's going to produce electricity for 30 years. Over the life of the system, it'll produce about $78,000 worth of electricity for your $18,000 investment. Not bad. That's going along in the market, but that's not bad. You know, and especially since you know you're doing it at a fixed price. So that's how you actually make the determination of the return on investment. First, you have to look at what the amount of electricity is that you're using, how much of it is going to be offset by the system, how much is it going to produce, what's your cost of electricity, and what is your total cost of your system net of all of the state and federal incentives. And at the end of the day, you're back to a point where, again, no consideration for inflation, 11 years for an investment like that, virtually no moving parts, or 10 years even if you factor a 3% cost increase in the energy. Questions about that? So that's pretty dense.
This example is for your home. What if it's so efficient that you put more into the grid than you need?
You would not want to size a system to be any larger than what you use.
Okay.
Ever. And, you know, here again, I'm trying to work from the basis of a brand new home rather than somebody's bill. I mean, I could show you a bill. I mean, to use an example, when we configured our solar system for our home, my three boys were home. And they used a fair amount of electricity. And they, after we installed the system, we're all moved out. And it was just my wife and I. And our bills plummeted. And it's been great because my system produces a great deal more electricity. But could I have sized it smaller? Absolutely. Do I smile because I haven't paid an electrical bill since 2009? No question about it. But when CLMP buys the excess production of electricity from me, because I have what's called a net meter, it measures how much I buy and how much I sell, it's a two-way meter. When I get the bill and it shows me that I have a 3,000 kilowatt hour credit with them, I go, oh great, that's about $600 worth of credit at about 20 cents a kilowatt hour. When they purchase it, which they do once a year, the end of March, every year, they purchase it at the wholesale generation rate that exists at that moment in time. The last few years, that has only been 6 cents a kilowatt hour. That's what they pay for. I get the credit for the full amount. You know, so you're optimally trying to balance usage. So whenever I'm talking with somebody about a photovoltaic system, I'm immediately asking either for access to their CLMP account so I can see what their average daily usage is and go back over 2 years, or I ask them for copies of their bills, which also will show, you know, at least 12 months of usage history on a daily basis. So we can go back and go look at that. Because you never, ever, ever want to size it for more. The cost is not, you don't want to be a utility. You know, the economics of it just simply do not work, you know. And you have to be buying panels at prices that are very, very inexpensive, and you have to commission huge construction projects that you're going to put up something like what they've done at Berkshire School, as an example, which is, I think, 1.5 million watts a 1.5 megawatt plant up there. So it's, but that's the only kind of level it actually starts to make any sense at all to be a utility. So for your home though, because the state will incentivize you doing it for your home, it makes perfect sense for the state to incentivize it, because then they distribute power more evenly, if you will, across the grid. And it doesn't then require the utilities, at least this is what we're told by the utilities, to continually make huge investments in power plants. And it's much more cost effective to invest in individual, so to speak, power plants and a distributed grid than a $2 billion tab to build a new gas-fired generation plant here in Connecticut. So that's why they do it. You know, economically, it makes sense for them. They're not giving anything away. So just a final word on PV, and this is I can send this to anybody that anybody wants to really pore through the details of this. The DOE did through the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, a study where they went back over home sale prices and did a very, very careful evaluation to see if there was actually a premium to be had by making these investments in any types of renewable energy systems. And what it demonstrated was is basically the premium equaled almost in all cases whatever the investment was. So if you spend $15,000 and you have a $200,000 house and that's what the market would bring in your area, well, now you have a $215,000 house. So it's like a dollar for dollar. You just, there's no loss. And all you've done is cut out your electricity bill. It's, you know, people always go to me after I go through this and they go, well, why doesn't everybody do this? Well, not everybody can, you know. They don't have the roof. They don't want to look at it. They don't have this, you know, the interest in even dealing with it, you know. But the economic case is airtight, simply said. Now that, what we've been talking about is called solar photovoltaic. That's generating electricity. But most people don't think about this as an opportunity here in Connecticut or in New England in general, but believe it or not, it's very cost effective. Solar thermal. These systems can have different applications, but the main idea is you're collecting infrared radiation. You're not collecting photons. Photons are not being converted into electrons. You're actually taking the infrared radiation that comes from the sun, and you are turning it just into a battery, if you will, of heat that you can use to heat things with. Radiation, obviously, is one of the three sources of heat, the other two being conductive and convective. And although the collection of heat energy from the sun can happen for many reasons, the three most common in residential construction are either domestic hot water, radiant heating, like what's in the floor here, or pool heating. And you travel away from Connecticut, you'd be amazed. Certain states are actually moving now, particularly down south, to require swimming pool owners for new construction to, before they even consider putting in propane or natural gas backup heaters on their swimming pools, they have to first put a solar thermal heating system on the pool. So, but these are the three most common. Solar thermal collection panels are rated in the BTUs collected, much in the same way that a panel, a PV panel, is rated for what its watts output will be. A solar thermal collection panel is similarly rated for what it will collect in BTUs. Basically, very conservatively, again. See the offset from the present energy source very clearly as a result. So, when you're thinking about, you know, potentially a solar thermal domestic hot water system, a way to heat the hot water here, which is one of our goals. One of the manufacturers that I work with pretty closely has agreed to give the STC at least one panel, if not two, if they don't mind one of them that's a little banged up that got dropped in transit. But it's going to be on a roof, we think, and I don't think they're going to care. But we can put a two-panel system in here. Now, obviously, we've only got, you know, a couple of labs and a couple of slop sinks, and so we've got to consider what we want to do with all that. So we might want to dump a component of it into the radiant floor, so at some point I'm going to need to spend some more time with Champ and, you know, and Frank and talk about how we can actually do that. But in a very simple consideration in a home, where, as you saw previously, how much, as an example, electricity an electric hot water heater uses, and you'll similarly see conversions for propane and for number two fuel. I leave off natural gas because we don't have any around here to speak of. You know, if I was down south or if I was down in the Hartford area, we'd be talking about a little bit differently. But up here, we're propane or number two. So, but we, when we consider solar thermal, we size it based on the number of occupants. And these are some basic statistics here. You can see here the consumption per occupant here for houses and flats. Our gallons per day are anywhere between 20 and 35 gallons per day is what the average occupant uses. Now that's not, I mean, my son's left so I can talk about him now. That's not the showers that the kids take. It's literally everything. That's hot water for dishwasher, hot water for your washing machine, besides whatever you use, you know, to bathe with. So 20 to 35 gallons per day. And you can see that there can be a peak demand. So sometimes, depending upon what you're trying to configure for, you might want to configure for a peak demand. If there's four people in the house and they all want to take a shower at 7 o'clock in the morning, well, you might need to configure for that peak demand. So, but it needs to be talked about. But that's the starting point whenever you look at the need for how much BTUs need to be generated. How many occupants are there in the home? So based on some of those consumption statistics, a family of four would consume anywhere from 80 to 140 gallons. And given my experience, I'm going to start at the top. 140 gallons of hot water per day. So if you were bringing 140 gallons of water in from your municipal water supply or your well, at 55 degrees, which is what it is coming into you at, 50 to 55 degrees. And you're going to heat that to 115 degrees, as we showed you before. That's going to require daily 70,140 BTUs for comparing propane or oil, or 20,551 watt-hours, or 20.551 kilowatt-hours, just in electricity, just for that use.
Oh, question. You're talking about the water coming in from outside source at 55 degrees. What is the feasibility of having water storage in a house that wouldn't necessarily thermally heat it, but just being in a space, not in a basement, but you know, somewhere in a living area where it would get 65 degrees?
Absolutely.
Is that being done? Is that just take up too much space and not practical for most homeowners?
Well, you know, to your point, very well said, is that we're actually putting a 700-gallon storage tank into a house over in Millbrook that's going to be part of the offset for that, because not only are we going to use the heat that's gathered from an evacuated tube array that we're going to be putting up for this this home, but we need that big a battery, if you will, and that's what basically what you're speaking of. It's heat in another place. Now, even if I'm at 65, to get to 115, I've got a 50 degree rise. You know, so that's part of the point. And if I'm pulling the water through, that water temperature in the tank is still going to fall relatively quickly. Is there as much of a benefit to keeping the storage like that? Yes, if you're going to ramp up potential usage. And as a rule of thumb, you know, and there's a lot of debate about this in terms of the way that you actually convert the thermal energy. My recommendation is, even though you may have an 80-gallon tank today and that's sufficient for your needs, get rid of it, go to 125-gallon tank, and have dual coils in there, one for your solar thermal glycol loop, and the other for a secondary source, which may be a loop off of your boiler, so that you've got backup to it if you're that far down on it. But you know, here again, each configuration's very different, and I don't make any, you know, general pronouncements about it. what I'm trying to go through here is just the foundation of the calculations that I have to go through, you know, to be able to demonstrate what would occur. So if I've got four people in the house, I will take the 140 gallons here like this, times the 8.35 pounds per gallon, and times 60, which will equal the 70,140 BTUs. Again, if I'm gonna convert that to watts, that's 20.5 kilowatt hours of electricity. And at 20 cents, you're about $4 worth of electricity per day just for heating hot water. So, now, cost comparisons here. Going through here, we know what the BTUs are that we need. The BTU potential in a gallon of number two fuel oil is 140,000. It's the highest. BTU potential in a gallon of propane is 91,502 BTUs. If you think about it, the cost of propane these days is pretty close to the cost of heating oil. So some of those efficiencies that were available to convert and the reasons for converting to propane haven't panned out as much as one would have liked. Me speaking in particular for myself, as I converted from number two to propane. But I did for other reasons too, because I couldn't stand the smell of the fuel oil around the basement. It was bothering me too much. But if I make the conversion, typical boiler efficiency on oil furnaces is about 80%. If you've got 80% efficiency on your boiler, on your oil burner, you would be happy. And many times they run at much less efficiency than that. But if you're running at 80% because you're keeping it tuned up, you're really getting about 112,000 gallons, or 112,000 BTUs out, and that would equal about 0.63 gallons of oil per day at $4 a gallon, so that's costing you about $2.52 to heat that water. And in propane, it's gonna take you an extra dollar, about $3.65. The propane boilers are generally more efficient, so that's why I can take the 91,502 BTUs times a factor of 0.95. So here's the one that's the killer. 20,551 watts times 19 cents, that's $3.90 a day. Really clear, you know, those of us who still have electric hot water heaters, whenever we come into a situation where somebody wants to talk to us about photovoltaics, as an example, our first question is, how do you heat your water? Because the state really doesn't want to talk to you very much about your incentive if you're going to continue to heat your water with electricity. They also require you, as I mentioned last year, to go through what they call a home energy survey, which is still this very, very wonderful, very inexpensive process that everybody should almost be required to do as part of maintaining a mortgage, as far as I'm concerned. Just so somebody comes through that's objective and identifies where a home is losing energy. There's a number of different ways to do that. But the home energy surveys that are done today use, in particular, blower door tests. And then they can walk around and they can see, you know, with thermal guns, where you're getting huge heat loss problems. So very, very interesting process. Much more scientific. So price comparisons. You know, your solar domestic hot water system, the price comparison. They're rated, as I mentioned earlier, by a certifying body based out of Florida called the Solar Rating and Certification Corporation. It's a nonprofit that actually does take the panels and actually determine what their BTU outputs are going to be. So that there is some credibility to the claims of the BTUs that are going to be output. And the testing is based on average climatic conditions, again, for different locations. And in our example, the system would require four average flat plate panels to provide BTUs. Each one of these panels is capable of about 18,100 BTUs per day per panel times four equals 72,400 BTUs. So that'd be four panels up on your roof for the family of four, just coincidentally, to actually offset. And the panels, believe it or not, are the least expensive parts of these things. you know? It's not the panels that are the pricey parts of doing this. It's getting the glycol down off the roof, penetrated through your roof, through roof boots, connected to your equipment, hooking up the pumps, you know, balancing the systems and maintaining it. That's where the costs come in. But it's not the panels. The panels are way sub $1,000 each now. So. So a four panel system installed in a home around here would be in the $9,500 range. That would be what I would propose, you know, presuming fairly simple, straightforward runs down to the basement or wherever the mechanicals are today. And there are federal incentives for these systems as well. So 30% federal tax credit. So $9,500 times the 0.7 would be $6,650. The state comes and goes with incentives for solar thermal, unfortunately, very, very, very quickly. And they've had the programs on and off, on and off. They come on for about 2 months at a clip. They're very well spoken for. What happens is you go on a wait list, and when the money becomes available, then you have to get your system installed in that window, and then you can take advantage of the state money. The state incentive on a system like this would be about $1,200. So it really isn't, when you get right down to it, worth it. But in terms of the offset, it's $1,250, but at the end of the day, what you're talking about for a system payback on a unit like this at $6,650 divided by the 3.9 at the cost of electricity as an example, your payback would be 4.67 years. So solar thermal is really a good investment. It's a much quicker payback. What I'm going to move on to real quickly, in respect to time, is just a quick discussion about using renewable energy to heat a home. This is where you really, if you're going to heat a home, you think in terms of the tanks. But one of the benefits of radiant floor is, put your hand on the floor. Feels cold. It's because your hand's 98 degrees, but that floor is 68. And that floor is heating this entire room to 68. Radiant is a totally different heat. It's an incredibly different way to feel heat. It's not convection. It's not conduction. Radiant makes the entire space warm. And it actually can be retrofitted into homes. There's different ways of doing it. Either staple up radiant floor, depending on the circumstances, you can actually pour it's almost what they call a gypcrete that will actually go over an existing floor. You'd strip off your flooring and then you actually pour a material that covers up the radiant tubing. And you know, you may have to change some door heights and all the rest of that, but there's ways of doing it. Either from underneath or over the top. And radiant, we have a 1,000 square foot area in one of our retail buildings that we put up last year onto a radiant floor. And I have a tank of water, 80 gallon tank. I don't need a particularly big one. That what I'm doing is I'm still, even at this time of the year, I'm getting 85 degrees off of the roof. Not with panels, but with a different type of radiant system. It's hard to explain, but it's called radiant floor in reverse is what I call it. It's literally PEX, Alpex tubing, 1,200 linear feet of it, run underneath the photovoltaic arrays that's gathering the heat energy in a big box that basically we constructed on the roof. Sheathing down reflective material, the purlins for the PEX, with the PEX inside of it, big box built around it, and then we have standing seam roof or photovoltaic panels going directly over the top of it. And the temperature that we're able to keep in this tank is right at around 75 degrees. Perfect. Because I keep the room at 66, and when it needs heat, it'll circulate from that tank at 75 degrees into the room, going into it, it's at 76, 75, 76 degrees, because the room's fairly warm that it goes in. And it's coming back exactly at the 62 or 63 degrees that was at the call until it gets the slab, it's a big concrete slab, up to temperature. My point is with heat, if you're using radiant, you don't have as much need for as high a temperature. That's some of the magic of it. And you can actually effectively heat a home radiantly. One of the products that we've just started working with, and I've got an architect who was formerly trained in France, and she lives over in Warren, and she just came to us because she put all radiant in her home, and she's a brilliant, beautiful designer of homes, but she didn't think about where she placed the bathrooms in the house. And they both are on north walls. And the bathrooms get very cold. So as a consequence, they asked us to come in, and what we're doing is we're connecting to they're much more ubiquitous in Europe, but they're towel warmers. They're essentially just, you know, it's a type of a radiant tube that is going to be connected to the same system that the flooring is connected to. But now they're going to have something that's not under the floor. It's actually going to, you'll feel it, you know, after you come right out of the shower and your towel's a bit warmer too. So they're very excited about it. But, you know, this company that is based in Turkey that's going to give the panels for here are the ones that, you know, had started getting into doing this and found a real niche in market for them. And in Europe and in the Middle East, they're totally different about the way that they look at all of this. So that's why I say radiant heating is able to be considered, but if your current heating system is what they call hydronic or hydro air, you require a minimum of 180 degrees to actually be able to power hydronic baseboard or hydro air, which is you have a heat exchanger inside of a box that you're blowing air through, and that's how you're getting warm air if you have a hot air system in your home, most commonly. So, they don't work, but on radiant they do. As I said, you just need that much less temperature, 120 degrees or less, to actually do radiant. And you can do radiant in conjunction with domestic hot water, very easy. I mean, like I said, we keep that tank at only about 75 to 80 degrees. It also feeds two sinks. People are so used to, because of the distance from the sink to the hot water heater, they always got cold water anyways, so they'd never really say anything. I mean, if they stand there long enough, it'll start to warm up and they'll feel it, but you know, it takes a little bit of a while. Excuse me, I'm still fighting off the call. So what we were talking about, and this goes back to what you said, you know, in contemplating use of solar thermal for radiant heat and domestic hot water, you really want to increase that thermal mass so you have the bigger battery, so that you're not falling back to your, you know, whatever your current fossil fuel source, regardless of maybe electricity or propane or number two. And when you have that battery warp gathered, that you've gathered during the daylight hours, and the tank is big enough, like I said, even a good-sized tank will only, and if it's well insulated, will only lose a degree an hour. So if you can get that tank up to 90 degrees during the day, keep it up at that temperature, and it allows it to stay at that temperature, well, it's at the worst case going to fall to 80. And in conjunction with radiant, that's not terrible. And depending upon how in line, perhaps whatever you're doing to your domestic hot water sources are, now I've got an 80 to 85 degree feed into the tankless water heater. So I don't have as much of a rise that I would have normally had, you know, if I was taking straight well water, because that's your first feed. We're doing a similar type of situation for an animal hospital here in Northwest Connecticut I was astounded at the amount of hot water that they use in an animal hospital. And so it makes perfect sense to have this large thermal mass as being the opportunity to draw upon and still have the well water come into that tank, and then that tank be what feeds out to the two present, which will become the backup hot water heaters before they go off. You know, and so all we're feeding is the heat that we gather into that tank. So, if you use renewable energy to heat a home, there are what are called heat loss calculations to determine how many BTUs your home requires. I'd be happy to send this to anybody, but this is a really user-friendly calculator for determining this. Buildinsolar.com has this, and it's a very, very simple tool that'll do the calculations and kind of walk you through. But you need to know certain things when you get there, like, you know, what's the total area of exterior walls? What's the total area of fenestrations, doors, windows? You have to be, you know, what do you have for insulation in your walls, in your ceiling? And it will tell you what your BTU requirements are. This is a simpler version of what is now required to obtain a building permit now under the new building codes from 2009 forward, that you use a program typically called ResNet to make the calculations. That's the kind of the gold standard for making these calculations, and building contractors have to get these before they can even get a permit, and they have to be able to show what the BTU, the heat loss calculations are, and they have to demonstrate how they have used efficiency measures to minimize the amount of BTUs that are being consumed. But as I said, you know, insulation, ceiling heights, number of doors and windows, all factors in the heat loss calculation. But this is a great little, real simple calculator. All right, I'll jump right over this if nobody has a pool. But pool heating is, for whatever reason, and I can't put my finger on it, we did 6 pool heating systems last year. There are absolutely no state incentives for them. There are no federal incentives for them. And they even charge sales tax on them. So there's absolutely no benefit when you do a pool heating system, other than I'm always staggered by the amount of energy it takes to heat a pool. It's incredible. I don't have a pool. I took care of one when I was a kid. That's why I don't have a pool. So, but the good news is there's no need for heat exchangers when you deal with swimming pool heating, because you are literally just simply connected into the filtration and or heating loops that you have presently. Very simply said, here's your from pool with a backup heater, two pool, here's from the pool to your pump, you know, with a check valve going up into the collector and then back, heated down. This is a three-way valve, so it has a control, so if there's too much heat coming off the roof and into the pool, you don't want it above 80, it'll put more cool water than hot water, after it, simply said. But the systems are incredibly efficient. I equate these to the, take a garden hose and throw it out in your lawn and then run the water out of it. It's been sitting out there in the sun, that water comes out hot. It's the same thing. The systems that we've been working with were developed by a company based in Israel by the name of Heliacol. They are the number one installers of these. They installed them on the swimming facilities for the Beijing Olympics, the Atlanta Olympics, and all the rest of the major swimming venues throughout the United States and the world, frankly, many resorts and so forth. They're incredibly simple. They just snap together, and their technology is great. They warranty them for a lifetime, which is even more incredible. It's just PVC black pipe, Schedule 40 PVC black pipe. Couldn't be any more simple in terms of doing it. The biggest problem is where you put them. That's always the issue. But sizing the array to heat the pool was, you can't be that simple, because pool depths, if you think about, you know, you could have an 8-foot depth or an 11-foot depth, you know, and I've got to figure the gallons. It's all about the area. It's all about the loss based on the area of the pool, the surface area of the pool. Okay? So the calculation is simply done taking the surface area of the pool times a factor. And the factor here in New England is a 0.65. So if you got a 1,000, what did I use here? A 600 square foot pool, 200 by, or 20 by 30, and you want to be 65% of that, it'd be about 390, 400 square feet. Now 400 square feet, that's 10, 4 by 10 candles. So that's considerable. That's a good size array. That's a lot of area, 400 square feet to come up with on a roof, on a structure that may be relatively adjacent to your pool, is not always findable. But for whatever reason, I got lucky this year. And said some of them just really worked out. And they had pool houses or they had structures that they had no problem putting them on. And lo and behold, they already faced south. It was perfect. So what happens is then the average cost for a roof-mounted swimming pool heating system is about $19 per square foot. So if I rounded that up to 400 square feet, you're roughly about 7,600 in an example. Now that's for an average of now 78 degree water from May 1, and most people don't open their pools around here till Memorial Day, through September 30th, and normally they close them down September 1st. So you can actually tack the additional 2 months on and start thinking about closing down the pool that much later. So, excuse me. Since the daily average amount of BTUs produced by this system would be 394,000, presumptions of the amount of propane used to heat a pool vary, you know, by virtue of, you know, do we have a solar pool cover? Is there a lot of shading? I mean, I just came into a situation where they had a beautiful field where they built this very, very large swimming pool. And the gentleman, being in construction, decided to put a steel superstructure over the pool. And then realized he now was paying $6,000 a year to heat the pool because the pool gets no sun. And it's great because everybody can hang out around by the pool and not get baked and they don't have umbrellas all over the place, but the pool never warms up. So now what we're doing is putting the panels on the roof of this to take the heat down to the pool. Perfect, but you know, my gosh, it just the unintended consequences. When I looked at it, I said, "You did a nice job." And he goes, "Yeah, everybody loves it. It cost me a fortune to eat it." You know, in this case, if you were heating that pool, you were going to be using about 4.31 gallons of propane per day. So that starts to get expensive when you really boil that back. 4 gallons of propane per day, that could be around $16 a day just to heat a pool. Okay, so for a 153-day pool season, the amount of propane used would be 660 gallons of propane. At the current prices, that would cost about $2,500 for the season. For a 600 square foot pool. Take your cost, $7,600, divided by the propane, 3.15 years to get your payback. It's the most cost effective technology that you can use any of the solar products for, the renewable energy products. That's about it. So I apologize for going a little over. Kind of dense, a lot there. Got any questions, please, don't hesitate to email me. You know, like I said, there's this stuff here, we got business cards here. Anybody's got any questions, I'm happy to just answer questions about it. So whatever anybody wants to do. But thank you for coming.